Andrew Tillins, and I'm going to talk today about the evolution history of Madagascar's coral humans. Now, Madagascar holds over 20% of global climate diversity and just 0.01% of Earth's land surface. And within this diversity, we have the family Carrageelidae. Now, Carrageelidae, the clade, is around 25 million years old, and it is arguably one of the most interesting families of primates alive today. In it, we have the genus Microcebus, the world's smallest primate. We have the genus Mersa, the only primate known to prey on its own phylogenetic family. We have Allocebus, that went missing for 3 decades. And we have Carrageelius, the only known obligate hibernating primate. And it's Carrageelius that I'm going to focus on today. Now, as with a lot of Carrageelidae, there's been a lot of taxonomic revision in recent years. And in 2011, the phylogeny was scaled down to include just 3 main lineages, Medius, Crossii, and Major. In 2014, this went in the opposite direction, where not only was the 4th lineage re-established, but Medius, Crossii, and Major was split. For this research, I'm going to take a compromise, and I'm going to use the 4 main lineages, and for ease of communication about this, I'm going to call it species. But we can debate that. And so, and we're going to look at, I'm going to use genomic data to test the relationships among the 4 species, and I want to see how consistent these relationships are across the genome. And then I want to see, do geographic distributions reflect historical population sizes? And so just to give you a little bit more background on Carrageelius, they are nocturnal dwarf lemurs. They're found all over Madagascar in a huge range of habitats. The most commonly known one is Medius. Medius is found in the west. The west is very dry. Medius is a dry forest specialist, hibernates for 7 months of the year, and is one of the world's few tropical hibernators. From the smallest to the largest, we have Major, also known as the Great Dwarf Lemur. It's found in the east. Even by Madagascar standards, the east is incredibly diverse. The lowlands have localized climatic conditions, and Major is a low-altitude rainforest specialist. Crossii is a rainforest opportunist. It's found in the north and the east, although much of the distribution is still to be determined. And it hibernates, but it still has to take multiple sleeping conditions throughout hibernation, most commonly in nest-like structures, hibernating trees. And Cyprii is a true cold hibernator, thought to be the oldest species in the clade, and hibernation thought to be the ancestral state. During the active period, they're found high up in trees, but when it comes to hibernating, they actually come down and they hibernate underground. And this is Marina Blanco's photo of a hibernating Cyprii. If you can't find it, it's here. And so when it comes to testing relationships between the 4 species, they're incredibly difficult to sample because, as I say, they're found high up in trees, they're in isolated locations, and also it's near impossible to get import permits. And so we decided to take as much information as we could from single genomes. And to do this, we looked to the Duke Lemur Centre. If you haven't heard of the Lemur Centre, it's the largest collection of lemurs outside of Madagascar in the world. There's 21 species, kept over 80 acres, and they have a captive Medius population here. And so we sampled a deceased individual that was a result of 4 captive generations, and we used dovetail genomics to develop a reference genome. And so they developed a shotgun library. We sequenced this to approximately 60x. From there, we developed a Chicago library, 1 library per each database, and we think that Medius is around 2.7. Then a de novo assembly was performed. This used a modified version of Miraculous Assembly, and this is geared towards large genomes. And then finally, this was scaffolded with the dovetail high-rise pipeline. And this gave us a final assembler that was approximately 110x in coverage and had an N50 of around 50 megabases. So we had our reference genome. We now needed to sample each of the species. And for this, we sampled wild individuals. And so they were sampled and then re-released. And these were sequenced to approximately 30x. Because as I said, we wanted to leverage the information that we could get from single genomes. And so then these were mapped back to Medius. To remind you of the aim, testing the relationships and asking how consistent are these relationships across the genome. As we know, evolution forces can act on very specific regions of the genome, and it can create phylogenies that are discordant with the species phylogeny. And something that's been developed to help tackle this is Saguaro. Now, Saguaro develops phylogenies to each region of the genome. And so it takes SNPs as input, and we gave it 105 million of them. And then it creates cacti, as I say, for each region of the genome. So a cacti is a matrices of pairwise distance measures. And so it uses a hidden Markov model and a self-augmented map, and it's done completely unsupervised. So it's really cool because we're able to develop these phylogenies without any a priori assumptions. And so it found three topologies within the genome and plotted these as neighbor joining trees. The first topology, so in terms of cactus 1, was supported by 99% of the genome. And so in this we see a Cibriani major divergent topology. So you can see here that major cibrii are not only divergent from each other, but also from medius. The second topology that I found was supported by 0.11% of the genome, where we see a cibriani medius divergent topology. You can see how exaggerated this is, especially when we compare to cactus 3, where you see this two-clade topology. And so you can see the relationship here of cibriani medius compared to here, really quite different. And we can visualize where these are in the genome. And 0.1711 might seem, well, it is a small percentage, but it's 2.5 and 2.7 megabases, which are 16 and 17 distinct regions that are more than 50 kb. And so when we visualize where these regions are found in the genome, this is an example scaffold, and so 24 megabases long here, and you can see that the dark regions correspond to cactus 1. I also want to say that cactus 1 agreed with all previous topologies that had been developed for Paragalia, so this was really nice to see this. And cactus 2 and 3, and the genome isn't currently annotated, but when we do annotate it, it'll be really interesting to see that if the areas of the genome that correspond to cactus 2 and 3, if they have genes in there, and if these genes have interesting functions. And so at the moment, this is all speculative, because as I say, it isn't annotated. But what we can say is that from these analyses, we do have four relatively distinct species. And so it was correct to reinstate Cibriae as one of the lineages. It isn't a synonym of medius. And that the relationships between the four species are fairly consistent across the genome, like with exception of these small regions. And I'm excited to look into this because we've actually seen divergent selection on genes in these regions. Second question. Do current distributions reflect historical population sizes? Just to remind you of the distributions, we have these large distributions of medius and major with much smaller across the eye and cibriae. To do this, we use MSMC. Now, MSMC can infer the scale population of a single population as a function of time, and it can also infer the separation of two populations. It uses heterozygosity for this, so long stretches of low heterozygosity correspond to recent coalescent events, and short stretches of high heterozygosity correspond to more ancient coalescent events. Just to get your eye into the plot, this is example data. We have years ago on the x-axis, and effective population size on the y-axis, and you can see present and past. And we needed to give it a mutation rate and a generation time. And so, as you saw yesterday, Ryan Campbell has been doing a lot of work on mutation rates in microcebus, and we use this to infer the mutation rate for Paragalias. So, we found, to look at medias first, the faint lines are bootstrap runs, and you can see that medias comes in with effective population size of around 200,000, but then we see this big dropout at around 300,000 years ago. Major has a slightly more consistent effective population size. We do see that steep drop, but MSMC isn't very good at inferring very recent and very old, and so we're careful with how we interpret that. Finally, certainly Crossi-I was a big surprise. It has a small current geographic range, and yet we see this huge expansion again at around 300,000 years ago. And finally, Cibriae. Cibriae tracks major quite closely, which is interesting to me. But the most important point on this graph, I think, is where we see this separation. We see this dropout in medius and this increase in Crossi-I. And what we can say about this is that that decline in medias is pre-human occupation, so it isn't a result of humans arriving in Madagascar. As for the other waves and the pulses that we see, it could be a result of climate and how that affects in Madagascar. So when it's thought that when the climate became cold, habitat retreated, population declined, and then when things warmed up, populations expanded again. But again, this is very hand wavy at the moment. And we'll probably plot other genera and see if we see these drops and peaks across other carrageelids. One thing that I wanted to do but didn't have time to do it for this talk, and so it makes it into the future directions area of the talk, is to estimate coalescent across populations. So when I ran MSMC, I ran it individually for each population. But what you can do is you can run it across the populations, and it allows you to, as I say, infer the coalescent rate across populations. So when did ancestral populations separate? And you can see it's time again on the x-axis, and then relative cross-coalescent rate on the y-axis. And so you see it that a long time ago, the population was the same, and then throughout time, the populations have become more separate, and they become completely separate at around 20,000 years ago. And this is something that I'd really like to do in Carrageelids. I think it can help us tease apart these times a little more. I'm hoping that the divergence isn't too long ago for us to be able to detect a signal, because they're around 10 million years old, and so we will have to see. But this is next step. Also, as I say, to try and get a greater understanding of why we see these fluctuations. So why did cross AI increase in effective population size? Why did medias drop out? And so we're trying to find an explanation for this. And finally, as you say, priority is to annotate the Carrageelids genome. It's been really exciting to find out what is going on here. Subii and medias are like the super hibernators, and so it would be great if we can find any genes that are related to like fat deposition and metabolic regulation. And so we'll be looking into this ASAP. And that's it. I'd like to thank all the Yodelab, various funding sources, and in particular Marina Blanco, who is the queen of documents. That's it. Happy to take any questions.
Yeah, it could, it absolutely could. And as you say, at the moment it's very hand-wavy and speculative, and we want to find a cool story there, so that's obviously what we hope for, but yeah, we have no idea until we look into that further. Okay, thank you.